YouTube in the beginning is so freaking hard because it makes no financial sense.
Yeah.
Right? Like engineering, you make like 200K or something, and then you pour the same amount of hours in videos and you make like $2.
Yeah.
Like, why? Like, you know?
30 views.
Wow, we're profitable.
I said to my dad, hey, Dad, I'm thinking about going this route instead of dentistry, at least temporarily. He's like, wait a minute, like, what do you mean? Like, I gave up 10 years. Yeah. I worked overseas. John, you studied for how many years to be at this point? Yeah. Like, why are you going to be a YouTuber?
Clap it up. 1, 2, 3.
JBROS. Is that it? Is that on it?
Welcome back to the episode of
JBROS.
And
Joma.
Ooh.
Still a J.
In New York City.
Damn, Joma. We wanted to bring another bro, another very intelligent bro, to come and speak about various topics, including life in the city, life as a professional, YouTuber, dating life, love life, pro tips from a dater.
I'm not that pro.
Novice tips from a dater.
Excellent.
Let's give a little background for people who don't know.
Yeah.
Right, so you moved from
California. Bay Area.
Bay Area.
Yeah, okay. Bay Area. So lots of bros, but not like cool bros. Like engineering bros, right? And
so he's not cool.
Yeah.
Oh wait, are you from California?
Or how's life in the city, dude?
The city is really fun for me, especially because you don't need a car. You know, in Bay Area or California, LA, you need a car, right? So I could just walk out, hang out with friends very fast because I live in Brooklyn, so it's pretty easy.
What about prospects in New York City? Oh. Do you think the dating culture or dating...
So I recently broke up with my girlfriend like a few months ago, but I haven't really like gone into apps yet.
It's still raw.
Well, you got the clout though. You got the clout.
Yeah, I mean, I surprisingly, my clout is useless. It's funny. No, honestly, like, I started YouTube originally. I'm like, yo, I'm gonna get like groupies. I wanna get groupies.
Yeah, well,
so I have a million subscribers now. Still no groupies.
Dude, let's play a little icebreaker game to get to know each other. So you guys know this?
Are you sponsored by them?
No.
Alright, so I could swear?
We're not really strangers who's not the sponsor of this video.
Oh, I've seen this.
Oh, you've seen this?
I think you played it with like Frisia.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Give your partner a hug, not the crap.
Wait, easy! What is, okay,
going with that.
When this game is over, what will you remember about me?
Okay. Wait, this is a little bit of...
Let's start from level one.
There were other topics that we were coming up with, like money talk, money, love, passion.
Right, let's do it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like chase love, money, or passion.
Let's go money or love.
Oh, love or
money or love.
Damn.
Is that even a choice people make?
I think so.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I think it can be a choice. Imagine if you have a job offer and your girlfriend is moving to...
Oh, but is that what people think though when they think love or money? Are they thinking that scenario or are they thinking like... Do you chase a wealthy partner?
Oh.
That's what I was thinking, no?
Well, let's do both. Let's, okay. Yeah.
Because I would love to have a sugar mama.
Yeah, who wouldn't? So, would you be open to being a sugar baby?
I think I've already said this many times. Yeah. Hell yeah.
Is there a stigma against sugar babies? For male sugar babies?
Well, I don't want to be completely dependent financially.
What if you liked another girl more, but you have to provide majority?
Oh.
Or you like a girl... You're compatible,
mm-hmm.
but it's like, okay, maybe a 5 out of 10 to the love scale, but she provides everything. She's like, hey, my purse is yours.
It's like security versus like
you're the breadwinner.
Oh.
Cause I think actually some people do face this.
This is a real challenge, especially like in Eastern culture. If you go to Korea,
absolutely.
Guys talk about this. Like, well, who would you marry? Like a
진짜?
Yeah, 진짜.
대박.
It's like security or love. That's more.
I see.
Not money or love. Security or love.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Cause the problem is I'm pretty rich, so.
That's the problem.
Isn't there home?
Okay. My software engineering answer is it depends what scale, what the numbers are, like specific.
Okay,
like
so there's a spectrum.
How in love am I with her, with the other girl and stuff like that. But in general, I do think it's not worth it because it won't last forever. With like the person who can provide you security forever, right? I just don't think it can last, which is why it's usually like not a risk I'm willing to take.
Mm-hmm.
Like, does she love me though? Like the super rich person?
Yeah.
Well, honestly, if she really loves me, then I might go for it because No, because like honestly, one of the most important things is like your partner to truly love you, and care for you.
Yes. Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you might grow attraction because of that. Like sometimes you might not have that initial spark, that initial fire, but that's not usually what's important for a long-term relationship.
Yeah, yeah. You know what I mean? Then we talked about this before. I think because you didn't really experience that before, you don't realize like that attachment that you build with someone that loves you and you love back. It's like you might not love her at this moment, but
it's possible.
It's possible.
Yeah, because there are different types of love, right? Like there's the lust version, and then there's also the commitment version or caring version. I don't know. There are like many types, and sometimes like you know you might overlook the important ones. You know, because I've had girls who had guys chase them for a very long time, but it's only after a year or two or three that she's like, oh, you know what? I think I do love this guy. Like
it, 2-3 years.
Maybe I'm exaggerating, but more than a month. More than a few months.
I see.
Right? It's possible that to develop that love for someone. You know? And usually it's because like, oh, I'm not initially attracted physically.
Yeah.
But later on they realize like, oh, he's so caring, he's so blah blah blah.
And I think that it's the same for guys and girls. Like I feel like more girls are able to overlook the physical.
But I feel like most girls are they're just settling. No? No, no, it's like
just in general.
Just in general, like the guy who's been chasing for 2-3 years. Like they had other options, but none of them panned out. It's like, oh okay. It's a backup option that's gonna love me unconditionally.
So. Yeah.
No?
I think it's love develops.
I see.
Right?
Do you think that becomes more important as you get older? Like someone's profession or wealth or background?
Yeah. Oh, so here's the thing. I think I do get initially attracted to people with like traditionally good professions.
Okay. Does it say something about them or what?
I think. Honestly, it's just the shallow mentality, to be honest. You know how my, like, it's probably my mom, like, you know, oh, you have to be, like, you have to make money, or blah, blah, blah. So then if I have to put that for myself, then I see the goodness on other people if they have a good resume, which is a terrible way to look at girls. But I think it has been ingrained in me, and I'm trying to fix that, especially because I'm a YouTuber now.
Yeah.
So I don't even have this, like, doctor engineering kind of thing anymore. But I think you should overlook it. I do think in general, if they are in the same background, like engineering, for example, then it's easier to relate to each other too, though. I think, so that's why it's nice for me to date like someone who's an engineer, for example.
Did that affect you with your ex?
Yeah, so my ex was an engineer, and it attracted me at first. I was like, oh wow, cool, she's in the same like industry. But then like, I loved her because of other reasons later on.
I see.
Yeah. So it was like one of the reasons why I was attracted to her, but then later on, it's just pure like kindness and caringness that I loved about her.
Like New York City is like pinnacle of like non-traditional careers, especially for females.
So here's the thing though, but now I'm more open to non-traditional careers because I realize it's ambition that I care about. If she's really serious about her work or what she's trying to achieve, and even if she hasn't achieved that yet, I still find it very attractive because it's something she cares about, you know? Especially because I've been doing YouTube and I could see that like, yeah, sometimes you're just not lucky. And even if you're skillful, you might not get the rewards in. So you can't judge people by their outcomes, but more about like their progress or
their hustle, their grind.
Exactly. You said hard the work. Same exact thing.
Yeah. That's when I realized like, oh, I'm kind of maturing.
I think that's the right way to do it. And then, like you said, you touched on the parents instilling their mindset
or
their mentality on you. And if you grow up thinking that a person's outcome or a person's wealth defines their value, then that's, I think that's old thinking.
It's so toxic, that mindset that's ingrained in you from like this Asian parent. Like, and I think guys actually have it worse the other way around.
As we have to be that professional.
Exactly. If a guy doesn't have an established traditional career, it's like, automatically no matter how he's like qualified.
I think it's all in the execution in terms of parenting, because the intentions are good. They want you to have a happy life, because they're immigrants usually, right? And they want you to have a stable job so that you can be happy, so you don't like have to face the suffering that they've had, right? But sometimes the execution goes overboard where they kind of forgot why they want you to be a doctor or engineer, and then they kind of just go for prestige. That's when it's not good. But like, for example, my parents, when I quit Google, they were like fine about it, because they're like, oh well, now that you're making money on YouTube and stuff like that, we understand that you understand this world better than us. As long as you think you're safe and that you're making like decisions for yourself and you're not risking too much, then we trust you, you know? So yeah, I love my parents. They're great.
Your parents like more open-minded than the traditional Asian parents.
So in the beginning, I feel like they're kind of similar to other parents, but I think it was a little bit of my effort to kind of make
them. I see.
So sometimes we do joke about like even sex life stuff with them.
Interesting.
And it was, I think it was because of me, like I was able to kind of joke about it. Oh, you know, I think I impregnated like a girl. And then my mom would be like, you know, you have to have sex for that, right? Like, so they fight back now. You know what I mean? Back then, they're like, oh, don't say that. Like, oh, you know? So they weren't comfortable at the beginning. But then because I forced them so much, it kind of made us closer in that regard.
Your parents are woke.
Jason.
Yes, sir.
Got a question for you.
What is it?
New Year's resolution. Do you have any?
Yeah, I'm trying to read more, learn more, become more intellectual.
You are already.
Oh, thank you. But you know how I'm this way?
What?
Thanks to Audible, who's the sponsor of this video.
Oh, nice. What I love about Audible is that they have not only audiobooks, but also self-help content, fitness, meditation, getting better sleep. It's a whole library in your ear.
It's been revamped. They also have podcasts. And it's just like high premium quality content. And I think you cannot get curated content like that anywhere else.
And the best part is the way that the information is consumed. During my commutes, especially gym time, when I'm washing dishes, it's easy for me to multitask. With membership, you get access to the streaming library and also the Plus catalog, which contains more titles and more content than you can ever consume.
And that includes one credit a month for any of their premium titles.
This could make not only a great holiday gift, but a gift to yourself.
You know, if someone got me a subscription to Audible, I would really appreciate that.
For a limited time, you can get 60% off your first 3 months. That's only $5.95 a month. Make sure to use the link in the description, audible.com/JBRO, and we'll see you on the other side.
John, aren't your parents like kind of changing too?
Yes. I very much relate to what you were saying about YouTube now being, you know, a passion project that you can pursue.
Right.
Because like you said, well, we don't give enough, our parents enough credit when they're saying certain things. They were their kid, ultimately, right?
Exactly.
And they may say it in a distasteful manner if we don't actually think about what their intention was. So when I talked to, this was right after I graduated from residency, this was during COVID, right? And the offers I was getting as a pediatric dentist, it was nowhere where I thought I would be financially. So at that point, I was like, yo, let me try doing YouTube. I was doing my other side ventures, which was actually more lucrative than my days in the office. So then at that point, I said to my dad, hey, Dad, I'm thinking about going this route instead of dentistry, at least temporarily. And he got all flustered. He's like, wait a minute, like, what do you mean? Like, I gave up 10 years. I worked overseas. John, you studied for how many years to me at this point? Like, why are you going to be a YouTuber? And I only recently started to gain his trust by showing that, yo, I'm working my ass off. That I'm not giving up dentistry. This is a way that I can branch out and create my own brand. And then as soon as the money started coming in, he started seeing growth. He's like, okay, like he at least is like trying to make it happen.
Right.
I actually had a talk with him on the way back home from clinic. And it was a 1 year mark when I started with the construction with my team.
Wow.
And I was like, Dad, it's been 1 year. Do you remember this? And he's like, of course I remember. He's like, I'm very proud of you. And I was like, oh my God.
It's like that moment. It's like your whole life.
Because that was one of my most successful clinic days. And he saw the growth. And
like
that, I was like, I poked him on the side. I was like, do you remember what you said about my YouTube channel? Yeah. I was like, you know, almost half our patients that come in. And then he's like, okay.
He's like, all right.
I was like, Dad, like, do you remember what you said about YouTube and how that was a waste of time? And then he's like, okay, well, like, you worked hard. That was his way of acknowledging it. It did change. As soon as he sees security, as soon as he sees that I'm not gonna suffer,
right,
then he's like, okay, then let me leave him alone.
Exactly.
Like, if anything, YouTube boosted your current career,
right,
that you have.
That's amazing. I love this synergy. I think that's amazing.
And speaking of this topic, can naturally segue into the topic of money versus passion. Which was another thing.
This is really relevant to you.
Yeah.
Money versus passion.
Okay. Well, I think money is really important, first of all. And if you have to worry about money, you cannot pursue your passion properly. If you have to worry about money, right? The problem is you have to make sure that you're honest with yourself with how much money is enough for you to live like a comfortable life so that you can pursue your passion, right? The dumbest thing my brother said, which is actually kind of insightful, he's like, just get rich quick, man. That's what he said. But I think what he meant is like, if you get to a point where you're financially secure, then you won't make decisions based off of money. And because you won't make decisions based off of money, you might actually make better decisions for yourself, for your own interest. And if you like what you do, you probably do it better. Mm-hmm. And then if you do it better, you might get rewarded anyway. Mm-hmm. So it kind of compounds. That's why that's not the only reason, but rich people get richer. The rich get richer. Mm-hmm. It's because they're able to follow riskier projects, mm-hmm. passion projects, stuff that they actually really like to do. So they succeed in it. Right. And then it just compounds. So I do think it's really important to maybe sacrifice a little bit of your passion and work on something, for example, like engineering, software engineering, mm-hmm. that gets you like a decent position financially. And then once you're settled, where you think you can like live for like a few years without needing to worry about it, then you can like maybe pursue like the passion project. Mm. But what I did was I did both, you know. What I sacrificed was time,
right? Mm, time.
I couldn't hang out with friends that much because I had to do YouTube and like engineering. So yeah, so that's what I did. So I think money is really important. Passion is only easily achievable and rewarded if you don't actually think about money. But it takes a long time. It takes a high net worth before you can truly say, oh, I don't need to think about money, mm-hmm. right? So it's hard, yeah.
For sure, we can relate to what you've done, because mm-hmm. we're in a similar boat. Like, yeah. He was getting his residency. He was finishing his residency. I was like getting my dissertation. We're producing like 4 videos a month.
Yeah, it's crazy.
So we're like, oh, shit, why are we doing this? What's the purpose behind it?
You're like 2,000 views per video.
Yeah, at that time.
It's hard.
Yeah.
Seriously, YouTube in the beginning is so freaking hard, because it makes no financial sense.
Yeah.
Right? Like engineering, you make like 200K or something, uh-huh. and then you pour the same amount of hours right. in videos and you make like $2.
Yeah.
Why, you know?
30 views.
Wow. Yeah, yeah. We're profitable.
We're net positive.
Yeah, net positive.
What about you, John? Money or
He nailed it, man. Yeah. I don't know if I can even add on to that, because I see it the same way that you do. Mm-hmm. That you need to be in a financial position where your decisions don't rely on
right.
money. Mm-hmm. And if every move depends on money, then now what do you prioritize?
Right.
Can you prioritize your passion, or is that irresponsible?
Yeah.
And that's the mm-hmm. same thought process my parents had mm-hmm. when I was talking about YouTube, because at that point it wasn't profitable. Mm-hmm. So why am I going to drop something that is going to give me security?
Right.
Can I do both? But the thing about the both thing is that for me, doing both made sense, because I was willing to sacrifice, like you did, downtime, mm-hmm. a little bit of sanity.
Yeah.
But for a lot of people, when they want to do one or the other, and that becomes a huge risk now. And I don't think, if someone gave me the option of going creative mode or dentistry, I don't think I would have the balls to full out yeah. YouTube.
I see.
Some people do though, and they kill it.
I see.
That's the best decision they make.
Yeah.
For some people, they don't have that much time
yeah.
in their timeline to pursue that passion.
I would say, 2 years ago,
yeah.
I would never choose YouTube over mm-hmm. my job. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just can't afford it.
Right.
So what is that passion for you guys right now?
Well, I think for me, it's pretty obvious. Like, I just like making videos.
Mm-hmm.
And then obviously, I want to try things that are more and more challenging.
Yeah.
Like short films, feature movies, blah, blah, blah. It's like a long road.
Like, you actually make like a full produced films.
Sometimes. Very, very rarely, because it's expensive. Mm.
But it's crazy you're pushing the envelope in the YouTube space like that. Whereas like people are, here's my vlog camera, here's me, and like me goofing around and like showing little pieces and pieces there.
I think the reason is that there aren't that many people doing that. It's because financially it doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
Which is why, like I said, financially, mm-hmm. you can only pursue your passion if you're like financially free, mm-hmm. right? And I'm getting like kind of close to there, or I'm lucky that the stuff I like to do mm-hmm. does give me money. So in some sense, that's financial freedom. Right. So I do enjoy making these like fancy videos and stuff. And it costs a lot sometimes if you have to hire a full crew.
Yeah.
But I was like, it's fun. Like, this is what I like to do. So instead of, for some people, they buy Lamborghinis, or some people, they enjoy like golfing and stuff. I enjoy making videos. Mm. So I got really, really, really lucky that, I enjoy doing something, and that something pays me.
So you're investing both in your hobby and your potential
pretty much
income.
Yeah.
That's the thing I respect about you most. Mm-hmm. You can see the passion in your work.
Thank you.
Because sometimes I watch your videos, I'm like, oh my god, this guy went ham.
Yeah.
Like, did he have to? He didn't have to.
Yeah.
So that's just straight up your passion driver, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love going ham. I like being extra.
it's fun. So
it's fun. Respect. Yeah.
You can see from the audience, the comments, they're like, damn, here's another one. Right? And I think you're even saying yourself, I can tell even before you told me
that this is
like your passion project. Mm-hmm. This is something that you actually really enjoy doing. I think that's so respectable. Yeah. And I think when people see others truly chase their passions and enjoy mm-hmm. their craft, I think that's something that actually motivates other people as well to mm-hmm. pursue whatever sparks. Right. So I think that's really admirable.
I think going back to the beginning though, like money or passion, and I say like, oh yeah, you just gotta be financially free and then you can make decisions that are not like influenced by money. It's easy to say in theory, yeah. But it's very hard in practice. Like imagine even that, like imagine if I'm like a multimillionaire, right? Yeah. But then I get an offer saying like, oh, we'll pay you like 20 million if you do this for a year.
Yeah, I mean, that's a different scale.
Yeah, I'm like,
that's scale. I'm like,
yeah.
Cut the video.
You know what I mean? So like, it's all about
shutting down channel.
But luckily we don't get these kind of crazy offers in life. So it makes it a little bit easier because usually the difference is either like, oh, do you want 20% more or, you know, or like not 20% more, which is like a small amount.
Right.
So in that case, it's easier to make decisions based off of non-money.
Yeah.
But like I said, you have to scale it. Do you want to make 20 million?
Yeah. That's another
or $100 a month?
it's like, would you kiss a dude first? Jason said like $100.
Yeah.
Wait, but actually we're looking at somebody and we haven't actually got Jason's perspective on this yet. And this is something that we disagree with very much. But actually now that I see his perspective, I admire this in you. You've never made decisions based on finances. I feel like for you, passion is greater than everything else.
Yeah.
Even this YouTube project, you're willing to not take on sponsors if it means making more content. When we have this discussion, because this is a partnership, right, about where this JBRO channel is going to go, he's willing to give up a lot to chase the possibility, the potential of our growth.
Right.
And this is you, this is all you. For you, money has not been a huge driver in anything.
Yeah, I want to, when I do something, I want to do it because I'm passionate about it, and I want to do the best job of it. For me, it's more of the process and the goal, like getting there.
Even the opportunity of it.
Yeah, even there's an opportunity lost at other aspects in my life. I think you are more about efficiency and the output of the input that you put in.
That's very interesting. Yeah, I understand both worlds. Like, I'm very business-minded sometimes too, but I'm also very creative-minded. Like, for my film stuff, you know, I'm like, I don't care how much I spend. I just want to make the coolest shit. But for my other channels, or like trying to build more channels, I'm like, oh, it's just pure, like, doesn't make sense money.
Yeah, right.
For example, Six Strangers, it didn't, like, we couldn't get sponsors. Didn't make any money, but I'm not willing to sacrifice like my own personal money to keep the show going.
Yeah.
Joma NYC, I'm starting to have like sponsorships and it's pretty easy to make. So I was like, yeah, let's keep this channel. Let's make the same thing over and over again. I don't mind if it's not the best creative shit I've made. And maybe, I'm not sure, but maybe sometimes being business-minded and creative-minded, it kind of complements each other. It's kind of like same thing as balancing your work and your YouTube life. Like, because you're so busy, you're more efficient with your time. You have to make sure you're more efficient with your time.
Right.
So you're actually more productive somehow. Yeah.
And I think that's how our friendship works, because we try to understand each other from different perspectives. So being like, oh, you're wrong, like I'm right, but we try to like meet in the middle, and we're both like strongly opinionated people, right? But we at the same time, like, we work only because like we try to understand each other.
Yeah, you complement each other.
Yeah,
basically. That's really rare, like especially in the business world, you know, startup world, or even YouTube world, it's hard to find like someone else that you can work with. Like, that's what I've always done.
That's why you have to be the two person on your own.
Dude, there's gonna be so many characters in the future on my channel. Like, I have to play every character.
I really like this conversation because like we can like relate to
for sure
sort of backgrounds and like
so if you want to find true love like Jason and ours, then craigslist.com.
Find a roommate.
Now we're three.
Yep.
Yeah.
I brought my air mattress. Well, thanks JBROS for inviting me to talk about love, money, passion, and everything that, you know, that you care about. It was great being here, and I hope to read the comments because I'm always reading the comments. So I hope you got a lot out of it, because I definitely did just by talking with them too. So yeah, JBROS out.